Child, is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, compassion king, to own him, the King of Kings, salvation, and loving hearts enthroned him. Raise a song of God, the Virgin. For me, for you. Hail, hail, the Word made flesh, the Babe, the Son of Mary.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. This is Christmas season. We thank you. We feel your love. We feel the joy of the Holy Spirit. And we ask you that you help us to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say today. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Today, God wants to teach you his way. There is a way that God ministers to the people. It's a new way for me that God taught me in the year 2013. And I'm going to share the secret with you. Many of you, you go, you tell people about Jesus, and you don't see a great harvest because there is a better way to do it. I have seen the Lord coming and ministering to the people who were deep in their sin. When the Lord would minister to them, he will act like they have no sin. He will begin to look one thing where they are really strong. And he will talk about that. And he will strengthen that. And he will emphasize that. That's God's way to minister. And instead of him coming to you and saying, you have the problem with drugs, you are lazy, you are not reading the Bible, he comes to you and he says, by the way, you have a beautiful voice. By the way, I love it when I hear your sound as you sing. By the way, I love the smile when you sing. And he focuses on that. And as he speaks to you positively, you begin to get encouraged and strengthened, and the good sorrow, the bad and the ugly. That's the way of God to minister. What does this have to do with Christmas? of Christmas, the Lord guided me to teach you, yes, there is Christmas, and it's in the Bible. In the 21st century, are we still teaching people, yes, there is a Christmas? You would think after 2,000 years and plus, everybody believed there is a Christmas. But the enemy is so busy telling people, oh, there's nothing such as a Christmas. The enemy is busy distracting you all. Please, this is the story of the Christmas tree. And people go do a research, come up with books, a volume of books. And you are being distracted. And there is no joy, and there is no peace, there is argument why you should be happy and just celebrate. I tell you what, God is not in arguments. God is in the joy. This is a season to be joyful. Let's forget about all those arguments about the tree. People are too busy buying too many gifts. I don't like that. Well, God gave, for God so loved the world that he gave. Even if they might not be called Christians, even if they might not be called believer, but when they give, God is there because God gives, and God gives gifts. Whether they believe it or not, when they give, the light shines. Because the culture of giving is a culture of heaven. Let's go to the book of Luke chapter 2. Because I want to show you. There is Christmas in the Bible. And we are to proclaim it. And we are to observe it. Luke chapter 2, we will read the story of the birth of Jesus. Let's begin with verse 1 all the way to 20.
Now in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that a census be taken for all the inhabited earth. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was a governor of Syria, and everyone was on his way to register for the census, each to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, in order to register along with Mary, who was engaged to him and was with child. While they were there, the days were completed for her to give birth, and she gave birth to the firstborn son, and she wrapped him in cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over the flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths lying in a manger." And suddenly, there appeared with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men, with whom he is pleased." When the angel had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds began saying to one another, "Let us go straight to Bethlehem then, and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." So they came in a hurry and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. When they had seen this, they made known the statement which has been told them about this child. And all who heard it wondered all the things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary treasured all these things, pondering them in her heart. The shepherds went back, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, just as had been told them.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So Jesus is a real person who came in the flesh to save those who were in the flesh, those who are still in the flesh. Jesus is not something that is floating somewhere without a form. So he came as a real person that you could touch, talk to, hold hands, dance with. And because he was really, he came a real person, he has a birthday. It's here. That's why this story is telling us the day that Jesus was born. It was a busy day. It was a beautiful day. Now, look in verse 8. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the field and keeping watch over their flock by night. This is what the real pastor does. They don't go to sleep. They watch over your souls. I hope I'm that kind of a pastor. Hallelujah. Keep watching and praying so that when he comes, you see him. The Lord still walks by. The Lord still comes in our midst. We must watch and pray.
Amen.
Verse 9, and an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. Last night, as we were celebrating the birthday, the glory of the Lord came among us, right?
Amen.
And they were terribly frightened. I figured out why, when the angel in the Bible, they come, or the Lord, they say, "Fear not," because people tremble, they shake. It's frightening to see those angels who are so bright, even the Lord who is brighter than the sun. Can you imagine? When I hear that the Lord is brighter than the sun, I say, okay, let's give it a try. So I waited until the sun was at the max, and I say, okay, no sunglasses, we're gonna try. I couldn't do that even for a second because it's too bright. Can you imagine someone who is brighter than the sun? But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. God is not the author of fear. The author of fear is the devil. For behold, I bring you good news of a great joy, which will be of all the people." There is good news that he's going to share. What does the Bible tell us? Go and proclaim the good news. The good news is not to be a reporter of the devil,
right,
telling about what is going on. I am very sure that during that time, the devil was very busy. We saw it last week, how he was using Herod. Oh, what is he? What is he? Please tell me so that I can go worship him. The angels are not focusing on that.
That's right.
Surely there is a meeting going on in the pit of hell. oh, have you heard that there is the Messiah is gonna be born? So they hear, the devil knows some, not everything, unless you tell him.
That's right.
Don't be telling. That's don't right. be telling. So maybe the angels, maybe the enemy is going to try to send people to kill Jesus. Actually, we know that's true. Maybe there are even witches who are trying to do, who will try to do their magic. But we do not see the angel focusing on what the devil is doing.
That's right.
They focus on the good news. They focus on Jesus. They focus on heaven. They focus on what God is doing.
Amen.
That's what we should be doing this Christmas season, to focus on the good, to focus on the fact that he was born in this world. Not focus, December 25 is not the birthday. Not focus where nobody really knows the date, therefore you cannot celebrate. Not even focus on telling people don't celebrate Christmas. You know what the Lord told me the other day? He was telling me, if I preach that, I will end up in hell. So don't you go over there and start telling people don't celebrate Jesus' birthday. Do you know who is behind that message? It's the devil. Because if you remove that from the calendar, then what's next? Deny his existence. Let me ask you a question. Do you celebrate your birthday? We all do. Yesterday we celebrated the youngest birthday, and we also celebrated Jesus' birthday. We had a big party here. It was a dinner, girl. There was all kinds of drinks and no alcohol. No alcohol. Please don't misunderstand me. Don't say, Pastor said there were all kinds of drinks, and you go to the liquor store. If you go to the liquor store, we're going to find you, we're going to arrest you, we're going to stop you. Amen. Whatever is good, whatever is healthy, no alcohol, please. You know, one day I was visiting the Lord and I began to talk about what we will do in heaven. I said, Lord, you know how I used to love wine. I gave it up for you. So then, when I get to heaven, I am going back. And to drink it. He looks at me and says, what? I'm gonna drink wine. I gave it up.
We're not alcoholic.
He says, there is no alcohol in heaven. I said, Lord, yes, I know, I believe you.
Theirs is better.
Yes, wow. Much better.
It's new wine.
The new wine that you drink and you praise God more. You get high on the Most High. You drink it and you lift up in a good way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the angel said, I bring you good news. Whatever you do on Christmas, make sure you bring good news. Don't celebrate Christmas good news. To me, it's not. Don't celebrate. No! Let's celebrate! Let's celebrate Jesus. Celebrate. We used to sing that song. When I just got to United States, we used to sing that song and you would feel the joy. This morning, when we were worshiping, we abandon all the formalities and all the things that, you know, all the formulas, and we say, we're gonna celebrate.
Amen.
Wherever you have laughter and joy, and it's pure, Jesus is going to be there.
Amen.
Last night he spoke, he said, I had to come. Because we were celebrating, I had to come. I couldn't help but come. And so the angel said, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people right here. You can write it down. Christ's birth is to be proclaimed. The angel did not keep it to themselves. They brought it to the people. They say, you need to know, he was born today. We cannot keep this good news to us. We must share Jesus. We must tell you that he has come. We must tell you that hope has come down. Hallelujah. Remember back in those days, they were living in darkness. For 500 years, there was no prophecy coming forth. If you read after the book of Malachi, the prophecies, the prophet, that's why you don't see any more writing. For a very long time, God was very silent. And after about 500 years, 400 years, he broke the silence. Do not think that you have been abandoned when heaven is quiet. When it's quiet, get ready for a big explosion.
Amen.
The news about Jesus came like a big explosion because earth will never be the same.
Amen.
So Christ's birth is to be proclaimed. And not only that, it is to be observed. Because we see, after they broke the good news, they say, for today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This is good news. Reporting for God, not reporting for the devil. What he's doing, oh, he's using that Christmas tree and this and that. No, let's report for heaven. Let's report for our Abba. We work for God, not for the devil. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes, lying in a manger. The heavenly choir came down, and they began to celebrate. And they began to sing because this is a great breaking news, the real one breaking news. They celebrated. Now, these are angels. They are celebrating. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believe in him will not perish, but have eternal life. See how much the Lord loves us. The Bible doesn't say, for God so loved the angels so much that he gave his only Son. He gave his Son to you. That's how special you are. And the angels here, they are the servants. Do you know the term that we call like a boy who is a runner? You know, you tell them, go get me this, go do this for me, go do that. That's what the angels are. For the moment, we are made a little bit lower than the angels. But that's not your destiny. The destiny, the final destiny, when we get where we are going, hallelujah, and we have begun that journey already, we are the bride for the bridegroom king forever. Your relationship to God should reach the level of the bride. If I can put it in the real world. Can you imagine a man who is in love with a woman? Let's probably say they're not yet married, but they are probably engaged. They are planning and getting married. I'm going to take us back home the way it was. Like if she comes to visit you, you will have a boy that you call like a runner, you know. The boy will be ready that when she gets there, you send the runner to get whatever your beloved wants. You don't buy things in advance because back then we did not have the refrigerator. It's not like you're going to buy the steak 2 days before it will go bad. So you wait until she gets there. And when she gets there, you say, honey, what can I do for you? And after she tells you, the runner will go and just get everything. You don't go one trip. You can go as far as many, 7, 10 trip. Because we don't rush. We visit for a long time. And maybe we change the taste. We say, you know what? This is sweet, but not sweet enough. May I please have orange, Fanta orange? Or the orange one. You know which one I'm talking about? And the runner will go and get that. And you don't send them before because you don't have a fridge. You want them really cold and just fresh from the fridge. And the runner will go. The lovers, they stare in the eyes with each other. They talk. They might even talk all night long. How many people know that when you fall in love, we're talking about real love. We're not just talking the love that's not real. When it's real, and young people wait for God to take you through that real love because he shouldn't wait. When it's the real one, you talk all night long and it feels like it's been only 30 minutes. Amen. I see someone who is thinking, oh, I remember when we used to be on the phone all night long. And who paid that bill? Praise God. For unlimited. Unlimited. And so the role of lovers is to love each other. And they run and go and serve and serve and serve. That's why the angels are going out to us and they will be for those who reach the level of the bride. The angel will forever be there to serve you, you and your bridegroom, King Jesus. Amen. The point in telling you this story, it was not just for us to have a good time. I want to make a statement here. If the angels could come and celebrate this match, bring the good news, and the heavens open, and the choir of the angels from heaven come and just do live worship and celebrate, how much more do we need to celebrate? Hear this from the Lord. The season of Christmas, it's not a season to bring bad news. It's not a season to spread false teaching because you will be held accountable for that. It is a season to proclaim his birth, to tell people about Jesus.
Amen.
To tell Jesus about the Savior. It is a season to get word of the Bible and take your children through Luke chapter 2, verse 1, and through 20, and let them ask questions. It is a season to go in the highways, in the byways, and to bring joy to the downcast, to those who are hurting, to those who are in sorrow and pain. The season of Christmas is a season to bring good tidings of great joy. It is the culture of heaven. In heaven, as we talk, they are very busy. They decorate for Christmas, not for the angels, not for the elders, not for the saints who have gone on, even though they might be great men and great women of God. In heaven, it's all about Him. It's all about Him. And they put on the colors of Christmas. Some colors, they have no name on the earth. And the decoration always match the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Every Christmas, the Lord gives you presents not only on the earth, but according to the relationship you have with Him, and according to your servant's heart, He puts presents in your mansion. So when you go, it is going to be many, many, many years of opening them all because they pile up. And there is no rush because we have all eternity to do that. The best gift, that's where we focus. My friend, build your treasure in heaven. It is by serving. All those things you do not for me, not for yourself, they count. I pray that you all have great rewards waiting for you in heaven. Amen. On Christmas Day, the Lord dresses different from how He dresses in His everyday life. Because that's why you do, even on the earth, when it's a new, maybe it's a, you know, a wedding, it's a celebration, you dress different. Christmas is real, and it's in the Bible. God has given us Christmas not for Himself. It is for you and for me, and it's because He loves us. He gets born into this world, and we get the gifts. Christmas is a story of love, which began way, way, way back in the Garden of Eden. When God created you and me, it was because of love. Nothing but love. He told me He already had the angels. He already had the elders. But as I share with you, the relationship with God and the angels, it is like the relationship a man will have with the runner, that boy who go and get this and that. That's the relationship God has with the angel. But then He decided to create someone to love like a bridegroom loves a bride. It is the next level of relationship. He doesn't have that relationship with the elders. He doesn't have it with the angels. That's a relationship that is very special, deep. He did that for you, not for the angels. That's how much God loves you. So the story of God's love, bear with me, we are almost done. The story of God's love, it is shattered by the enemy who comes in the garden. And he deceived Adam and Eve. And he said, please, sin, because sin is going to break their love. And it really did, because they were expelled from the presence of God. But love doesn't give up. Amen. Love does not give up. When you love your children, even when they mess up, after a while, you wash it off and you say, okay, I hug you, I love you. Same between a husband and a wife. So God decided it was time to restore everything. And he wrote another story of love on Christmas. Love comes down and restores all things only through Jesus Christ. He who believes in him is restored back to the Father. He who doesn't believe in him is condemned to hell forever. Through Jesus, God restores everything. And the love did not stop there. All the way to Calvary, he dies for the sinner. He did not go back taking anything with him. He pulled out his life. The Bible says even when he was dead on the cross, the priest decided, water mixed with the blood came out. He didn't take anything back with him. He poured out himself like a drink that you pour out. The story of God, it's written, its origin, it's love. And it ends with love at the cross. Because he who dies for you, he who dies for a sinner like me and you, that person is real, and his love for you is real. If you see someone who comes with a gun and say, I will kill you, but somebody standing in between and say, no, you kill me first, do not doubt that person is real love. Anyone who is willing to die for you, they love you. Amen. And that's the story of Christmas. And that's why we have to celebrate. Because it's love that came down to save us. Let's stand up. Lift up your voice and talk to love. Talk to the one who has loved you in this manner, in this way. Never before have we ever seen such love. Never before has earth experienced such love. Dying for people who are not even yet saved. Risking everything and loving people who might even reject your love. Oh, never before have we ever tasted such great love. Tell him. Jesus, we really love you. Help us to love you. He's telling me, my children, that's how much I love you. My servant tried to explain in detail how much I love you, but she cannot because she's limited. There is no earthly word that can express my love for you. My people, do you realize I treat you every day with love? He's showing me, even when you hurt him, even when you disobey him, he still treats you with love. I see the Holy Spirit pleading with us. Would you, my people, treat God back with love? The Holy Spirit is saying, give it a try because I will help you. Let's commit to treat God with love. Let's commit to always receive God's love. Let's love him whom the Bible says, having loved those who were in the world, he loved them to the very end. Thank you for loving us. We bless you. And we glorify your name. We will close by singing a song the angel taught us. We come to worship the King. Christmas season. Let us forget about the arguments. Let's love one another and let's proclaim his birth and let's observe his birth. May God bless you. Remember to rejoice, to smile, and to be happy. Amen.